chat both makes me laugh and is very helpful. It reminded me that I forgot to turn off my mic. Anyways, it is Friday, July 31st, 2020, and that means that not only have you all made it to the end of another week, you have made it to the end of another month. So good job. Pat on the back. Good job surviving that and hanging in there. It's been a few crazy things going on, but some good things too, you know? Like, this past week, finally got a haircut again, which first time since, like, January. Feels nice to have a lighter head again. Been working hard on multiple different kinds of pages and comics and such. Also, I will warn you up front, if this stream does have some issues, we finally had the people from Rogers come in and check our internet, and finally, after 4 years, we have been fighting this. After 4 years, we finally got them to admit that the problem was on their side and it has nothing to do with our house. Finally! I cannot even begin to say how many times they've had us replace our modems, replace our wiring, replace our switches and whatnot. And finally they go and they tell us that yes, it was their fault, not ours. Oh. So they'll be coming here next week, try and hopefully fix that from their side of things. However, all that to say, if I suddenly drop or we have a few more technical issues like we've had the last couple streams. Like, are we having one right now? No, we aren't having one right now. Okay, good. I thought we were having one right now. I was like, oh, shoot. Please be patient. Full video will go on YouTube either way. But yeah. Whoo! End of another week. End of another month. This year has been more than crazy, as I'm sure many of you all know. Because world gone mad, crazy. World gone mad. But you know what? There's been a lot of people who've been really holding on through it. And there's been a lot of, you know, I've seen a lot of patient people, a lot of people helping each other out, a lot of new features raising up. And sometimes, you know, this might be controversial, but sometimes I think you need to have stuff go a little crazy in order to make people desperate enough to try and get to that next page, that next stage in life. So I'm kind of hoping that there'll be more people going towards the progressive, okay, you know what, things gone mad, how can we fix this and make the world better, than the things gone mad, let's go and go crazy. We'll have to see. We will have to see. I think there's been a lot of good, a lot of bad, a lot of all in the middle stuff. But yeah, we are hanging in there. We are almost through the summer. And it is a heat wave here. It's apparently also a heat wave in England. I don't know if it's the heat wave in America, but and we do what we do in the heatwave times. We drink hot tea. So for those who... I forgot to turn that one off. For those who were here on the Wednesday stream, we just finished reading my first ever published novel, Aldenair, which was honestly a lot better than I was expecting. I was really, really bracing myself for the cringe of reading something I wrote 10 years ago and thinking, oh, how much I've changed, at least I'm better than I used to be, etc. But no, you know what? There were definitely some editing issues, but it was actually a good story. And I can see why people have asked me a lot of questions about it and asked me a lot of if I was going to do a sequel and a prequel to it. Originally, there were supposed to be a sequel and a prequel. I have forgotten all except for the very basic amounts of the plot of the sequel and prequel, and it wasn't really working in the first place. Prequel kind of worked out, sequel not so much. But yeah, you know, reading through it again, it really was something special for me, and I'm glad I got to read through that again. But that is what has inspired tonight's topic, which is just discussing storytelling in general, because storytelling is kind of something special to me. When people ask me what I do, I am a published author, I'm a voice actor, I write cartoons, I like to dabble in video game design. But ultimately, what that all boils down to is storytelling. I love storytelling. I love coming up with crazy worlds. I love coming up with new characters. I find people fascinating. In fact, even when I'm teaching people, when I'm teaching Japanese people English, I would argue even that is storytelling, because it's a very, very similar feature, not just because I'm teaching English. But storytelling is something that I've really fallen in love with over the years. It's something that's always been a big part of my life. When I was a kid, actually, my sister and I, for For me, I'm dyslexic, in case anyone didn't know. I'm dyslexic, and apparently also can't speak my words out properly. Dyslexic basically means you see a word written start to end. I see kind of like jumbled up letters, especially with numbers. It was really annoying whenever I was in high school or middle school, and they say, they write on the board, you know, turn to page 538, and you go searching for page 538, and you have no idea where they are. Then you realize it was page 358, and it's just like, yay, dyslexia! And because of that, though, that was what got me into comics, because I love comics, because you show a dyslexic person a page of text in a novel, and all those words are jumbling around and switching around everywhere. You show someone a comic where it's like set panels and there's only a little speech bubble in each word and it's usually spaced out in simpler English, it gives you an opportunity to tell stories and such and read stories, which as a kid who couldn't really read the classic novels, I really appreciated. So my sister and I would literally spend hours upon hours just with dot matrix printer paper, and we just take off sheets and we would practice becoming newspaper cartoonists. We draw out the panels and try to come up with our own stories and our own worlds and such. And then similar to that, when it came to voice acting, we had the Fisher-Price tape recorder. If anyone has ever experienced the Fisher-Price tape recorder, it was something special. They have actually recreated the Fisher-Price tape recorder, except now it can only use their one specific Fisher-Price tape, which I think destroys the entire purpose of it, because my sister and I and my cousins would all get super excited when my parents would bring home a cassette tape they didn't need anymore, and we could rewrite the entire thing and cover it with our own acting and such, and we loved to do radio dramas. Radio dramas were a lot more improvised than they were with like stories and comics. We kind of cheated sometimes, we'd rewind and re-record, but the entire point was we would each take characters from a show or a movie or book, and in one take, as much as we could, we would just sit down, and you weren't allowed to laugh, you weren't allowed to lose or go for too long, and you just had to keep the story going. Whether you were accurate or not, you just had to keep the story going. And while these are just, you know, silly, fun kid stories, I could bring up other kid stories, like when we created life-size replicas of medieval weaponry and found out that an 8-foot-tall wooden battle axe can, in fact, splinter a wooden shield, and it really stinks for the person holding the shield. But those two specific stories are more important because it really shows how, you know, even the little things you do in life, it grows up to those big things that help you in your storytelling later on. Because really what those two things did was that they really laid the seeds for storytelling and improv, which I think are very closely tied together. For those who've watched the stream know, I have the cards here that I use for doing random improv things. We have the character cards, the theme cards, and the plot point cards. Actually, the real plot point cards I use are more handmade because these ones got misprinted. But that's a different matter. But honestly, improv and acting have helped my storytelling so much because I'm a method actor. When I act, I try to put myself into the character's shoes. I try to imagine what it'd be like to be that character. You try to think like that character. You don't just read the lines. You try to become that character as much as possible. I'm not as much a method actor as some people who will literally go and become a completely different person even off the set. But when I'm acting, at least, I really do like to get into the person's shoes and such. In writing as well, I really like to sit there, and it's a lot harder because you're switching between all your characters, not just some of your characters, but I like to switch between them, and I like to get into their heads, and I like to really become that character while I'm writing, and it can create little interesting things. For those who have watched my streams enough, they just know, they've probably heard me at some point say the word stinkin', that stinkin' thing, the stinkin' that when I'm really angry. I used to never say that word, and then I wrote a novel about 3 or 4 years ago, and one of the main characters used that word all the time, and ever since I wrote that novel, I have just, it comes subconsciously now, I keep saying the word stinking. Other things pop up as well, where it's just like, oh, that was from that story, oh, that was from that story, that was from that inside joke or whatnot. But you know what? When I first published Alden Air back in 2010, 2011, I think it was January 2011, but I wrote it in 2010. When I first published Alden Air, I self-published it, and back then, self-publishing was hated. It was really, really looked down upon. I remember going and talking to these other authors, and I was like, oh yeah, I just published my own first novel too. I was really excited about it and such. I just wanted to talk about it. And they're like, oh, really? You know, they're into it as well. And they're like, so who'd you publish with? I'm like, oh, I self-published on Lulu. And then all of a sudden, their face would change. You just hear them say, oh, you call yourself a real author? I mean, that's cute and all, but, you know, real authors don't self-publish. And you would get so much flack for self-publishing back then. Honestly, the main reason why I didn't write again for another 6 to 8 years was because I had gotten so much flack from the writing community back in 2010 for having the audacity to self-publish your book, which is extra funny because when I finally came back in about 2013 or 2014, the entire industry has so changed. A lot of it has to do with ebooks and how printing is going a really kind of rough time right now due to the fact of the cost of printing versus demand for printed books, and ebooks have really shook up the market. Like, I cannot even describe how many businesses have been struggling because of ebooks. I love ebooks, but yeah, we were not ready for them. We were not ready for what they brought to the industry. But now, because of all that, self-published authors are really your first step into the industry now. A lot of people are, not even a lot of people now, you know, honestly, with the writing community, about 2 or 3 years ago, I'd say a lot of people were still aiming for that, you know, getting a professional publisher. I think most people now have pretty much accepted that, no, just self-publish, because that's how we get started. And there are limits to it. I mean, me reading through Alden Air, I really, really wish I could get a professional editor to look through on that. I don't have the $5,000, $6,000 to make them look at that. It's usually about, I want to say 3 cents per word for a light edit and 6 cents per word for a heavy edit, which when you have a 60,000 plus word book kind of builds up a lot. But yeah, now that we go back there, even when I've talked to some publishers, because there are a lot of publishers who are like, oh yeah, we'll publish you if you get $5,000 for us to look at it and we think it's worthwhile or stuff like that, which I'm sorry, if you put a barrier to entry like that, it doesn't work out that way. We publish the book because we need to have the income from the book. We don't have the income to publish the book. This doesn't work. This barrier to entry does not work. I really hate it when they put in like barriers to entry like that are like a price gate. Make it a talent gate, make it a connection, not even a connection, make it a talent gate, make it a resource gate, make like a little starting area. Do not ever put a price gate on your industry. That basically just means that the only people who can start are the people who have already started, and the entire industry stagnates, and money doesn't mean you'll be good at it. Having money doesn't mean you'll be good at it. You're really just kind of pushing out the talent, and you're kind of, and those who would be actually desperate enough to try and do a good job, and you're making your industry stagnate, but it commonly happens. But even that publisher, when I was talking to him, one thing he said was how the industry as it is now, a lot of publishers, they look for self-published authors who have that audience, which is also kind of silly, because if you already have the audience, why do you need to have a publisher? But business. So yeah, find no shame in self-publishing. Ebooks are nice and affordable. Going through Lulu is one of my favorite ones, just because I've been with them for so long. They were one of the first ones that allowed us to self-publish. I can go through iBooks, Amazon, Kindle, Kobo, whatever Barnes & Noble have. I've never actually figured that one out. And I can make actual published books as well. Printed books. Printed books, of course, cost a lot because it's per book, not per bunch of books. But, you know what? It gets it out there. And honestly, there's nothing better than holding your book in your hand for the first time thinking, wow, I made this. And I think that is really worthwhile in itself. a lot of people, you know, they want to write a book because they want to make the next bestseller. They want to make the next, you know, big thriller, the thing that will be famous. They want to have a movie. I will admit, if someone offered to make a movie on Alden Air, I would love that. There's a lot of scenes that'd be really good as a movie. I was reading the book, I'm like, man, I wish this was a movie because this would look so cool in a movie form. But if you create just for the fame, just for the money, just for the movie or whatnot, you're going to be disappointed because honestly, most of us don't get there. I mean, I have not made a lot of money off of publishing novels. It's hard to market it. It's a lot of books out there. There's not as many readers as there used to be. I mean, it happens. There is nothing harder than getting those readers. Especially to get actual readers. You can get people to buy it, and they'll sit on their shelves for ages, and you're just like, no, you don't understand. It's nice that you bought my book, but it helps me nothing at all if you don't read the book, because what I really need isn't the money from you buying the book. I need you to get excited about the book. I need you to understand how cool the book is, and how, you know, really interesting it was, and talk to your friends about how exciting it was. In 2014, and this is actually what got me back into writing novels again, a high school girl in Toronto got a copy of my book, Alden Air. And I was just like, okay, yeah, sure, I'll send you a copy. I was honestly just wanting to get them off my shelves because they were just such a bad memory to me and such. And she got so into it. She made paintings based on it. She did her school reports based on it. She got all her friends to go buy copies. She messaged me numerous times, but, and this part, what does this part mean? What does this part mean? What does this part mean? And honestly, I thank her for the fact that I ever wrote another novel again, because that was so encouraging. And it didn't go as far as it was going to go. I almost got my book added to the school board in Toronto, which would have been awesome. I mean, finally have some good books on the curriculum. Sorry, bad joke. But yeah, it was the fans and people reading it and people enjoying it. Even if it's just one person who gets touched by your book and one person who really enjoys your book, one person who's just like super impacted and excited about all the different things and how does this all work out and how does this all work out? Honestly, that is worth it. That is so worth it. In voice acting, Bob Bergen, the voice of Porky Pig and a couple of others and such, very famous voice actor. He has a phrase, and I agree with it and also disagree with it. He has the phrase that he gives to all aspiring voice actors of never do it for the money. Do it because you have a chance to get behind the microphone again. And the artist side of me gets that. I am mostly an artist person. I am an artist person with a business degree, which is a really weird combo. The artist side of me gets that because honestly, I don't write stories to be famous. I don't write stories because I think this will be the next bestseller. I write stories because there is a story in my head that is willing to explode my head if it doesn't get onto paper. Like, there is a massive need to get this out there because it's just like, this story has to be told. If you are a storyteller by nature, you will understand this feeling. Just this feeling that, you know, this is so cool. I've got to get this onto paper. I've got to get this into a comic. I've got to get this acted out. Just somehow I've got to get it out there. Unfortunately, the amount of time it takes to transfer said story from your head onto medium usually helps lower the motivation for that. But still, like, it's just that drive that goes in there. So I do get that artist side of things. But then there's my business graduate side, which also says you need money to live. I'm sorry. I mean, it's nice and pretty to say that, you know, do the art for the sake of the art and nothing else matters. But no, if you can't eat food, you can't live long enough to make the art. I prefer the Jim Henson method, which is the make art to make the money to make the art, which I have a book that's based on his business strategies, which was actually a surprisingly interesting read. One of my favorite lines of it was talking about the differences between business-minded and art-minded, where business-minded people want to get the... I should start with the artist one because it shows the contrast better. The art-minded people want to use every resource at their disposal to create the greatest thing that has ever been created. Highest quality, best, most impactful thing ever. Business person wants to get the most bang for the least buck. this is why these two tend to clash a bit, because this person, the artist, wants to use everything at their disposal to create the best thing that they can. The business person just says, okay, what is the minimum viable product? How little can we spend to get as much impact as we can? And that doesn't always line up. And you really need both, because if you just rely on the artist mindset, you go broke. If you just rely on the business mindset, you go stagnant, and then you go broke. A lot of companies right now are dealing with that stagnant period, where they have so systemized and so, you know, just put in all these different things that they haven't, you know, focused on just pushing themselves to create something amazing. And that's when you go stagnant. That's when your customers start to kind of wander off to find new things. And that's when the new up and coming businesses start to overtake you. So yes, you do need to have both. And it's kind of that realist, but also keep that spark of hope and inspiration for you. But realize you need to earn the money first before you can really go crazy on the arty stuff you want to create. And for someone like me, who is physically incapable in a lot of different ways to do many jobs now, getting that money is very tricky at times. But, you know, you do find ways to create. You do find times to create. You find, you know, between appointments, when you're kind of there and you're recovering from your appointment, you find that time and just kind of, like, make yourself create. You can't force it. The moment you force art, it starts to just die on you. I mean, I can have two people write a book that has the same system, but one did it because they felt the system was right at the time, didn't really actually think about the system as much as they really want to tell the story. The other person just followed the system to the letter. The person who follows the system to the letter, it's cheap. It doesn't work out. You can't systemize art. It doesn't work out that way. When we try to just follow the tropes, and there's so much hate against tropes. Tropes themselves are not bad. Tropes are actually, you know, they're tropes for a reason. They're good storytelling techniques. But when we do tropes simply because they're tropes, and because, well, every story has this, so we have to have it too. This is the way you tell a story. When you stop putting the thought into it, that's when your story starts to suffer. And that's when people start bringing up the bad tropes, because it's not that the trope itself is bad. It's that we so have gotten used to just making the trope that we've stopped thinking about why we're doing it. And when I'm instructing authors and giving them advice and such, one of my chief pieces of advice that I give them is always ask why. Why is your most important question you could possibly ask? Why are they doing this? Why does this matter to them? Why were they impacted this way? Why would this matter at all? Why didn't they do it this way? Just keep asking yourself why, because that is the easiest way to do story world building. I mean, really, when you're building a story, you want to have a before state of your world. You want to have, you know, it's basically a balanced state of the world. If nothing happened, the world would just keep going along in its normal way. This is what the world's normally like. This is what has led this person up to this point of their life. This is what's caused all the characters to value the things that they value. And don't be afraid to ask the questions that no one's ever going to figure the answer to but you. I usually have about what I call an encyclopedia for each of my novels. It's about twice the length of any of my novels. And it's just all the history. The biggest one I ever did was Wireless, which was my superhero comic I did back in college. And it had about 80 years of history and about 60 years into the future for it, for a story that spanned about 4 or 5 years. And no one's ever going to figure that out, but it was there. The information was there. The history was there. And it's important to think these things through, because you could have, you know, here's this villain. He's the bad guy. Why is he bad? Why does he care about this? Why is he going through so much effort for this one little thing? You've got to ask yourself the questions of why. Why does this matter to them? What a lot of people don't realize is that no one actually does anything for no reason. Even if it's a really stupid reason, even if it's a misunderstood reason, even if it's a reason that doesn't really make sense to anyone except for that person, every action someone takes, whether it be a good action or a negative action, every action they take is because some logical conclusion they've made that this matters to them. Usually it's because they either fear losing something or hope to gain something, but there is always that logical reason that will drive their actions. And by coming up with those logical reasons, you can go through each and every single character, even if it's just a random character on the side who is like the friend of a friend of a friend. You can ask them, okay, why were they there that day? Why would they be witnessing this? Why are they needed in the story? And it's not too bad to put in. I disagree with some authors on this one, because I've seen authors say the opposite on this matter, but I don't think it's really that bad to put in useless characters sometimes. You know, have a character who maybe doesn't have no purpose to the story. I think that we often mistake no purpose to the story with characters who just have no purpose for existing in general. Because you can have a character who technically the story could have gone on without them, but if they're a well-thought-out character and there is a very logical thought to them and they are very well, you know, planned out and very well designed, they have clear emotions and such, then suddenly they actually become a love character in spite of their lack of necessity. And I think sometimes it's nice just to have a break. I mean, it just gives us a bit of distraction, makes the world feel more real, because you pass by many people on the street and they aren't all going to impact your life horribly, but they are there. They have their own lives. They have their own stories. And that's, again, you're going back to the asking why. Why are they there? Why did they walk down this way? What would they think if they saw this? And how will it impact them? Just by asking yourself those questions for each and every single character, you start to build out that world. You start to construct that history to that world. You start to design, well, this character is shy. A lot of my main characters end up being shy because, fun fact, I'm shy. Yeah, fun fact, if you ever want to psychoanalyze an author, most authors will write a story based on themselves in one way or another. We often are taking parts of ourselves and putting them into each of our characters. So if you see something come up in a lot of authors' works, it usually means it's something that they themselves either deal with or want to be or whatnot. But yeah, it's kind of a truth, as awkward as it can be sometimes. So a lot of my main characters are shy. Why are they shy? Did they get bullied in school? Did they have their hopes dashed? How did this affect them growing up? Did they make many friends in spite of being shy? Were they judged for being shy? Did their teachers or parents or whatnot try to confront them on being shy? Did they run away from that confrontation? And by creating that history and creating those answers, I often call it taking my characters out for dinner. If there's ever a character who I feel just their storyline and their dialogue isn't that good or that natural, I'll start to I'll take them out to dinner. I'll pretend I'm having like a dinner with them. And again, it's kind of that method acting type thing. They're sitting across the table from me. Just ask them questions. So what was it like when you went to school? You know, any hobbies, any interests? And by just doing that sort of silly dialogue with yourself, you start to get to know the character. And as you start to get to know that character, you start to understand that, oh, well, this person won't act this way. This person would do this instead. This person, because they dealt with this before, seeing this happen would make this react horribly to them. It's something that I find a lot of non-authors don't get. Actually, I've seen a lot of people make jokes about this, but it's very true, is the fact that, honestly, authors don't have control over their characters like people think they do. Because characters, once you design a good character, it gains a life of its own. I can't go and make Brett suddenly smack his teacher across the face and flirt with the girls. I can't make Kyle Canton go and spit in the face of his enemies. I can't, you know, make Maku go and say, oh, my sister doesn't really matter, she can live or die or whatnot, because as you get that history to them, as you get that personality to them, you start to realize there are things they can't do because they've already gotten these motivations. They've already gotten these drives to their personality, these cores to their personality. And once they start to get that core to them and start to get that drive to them, that direction, it almost starts to get locked into place, which can be frustrating at times. But in other times, the story starts to write itself as you're going along because you might not know what comes next. Honestly, I very rarely know how my stories will end until I get to the end of them. I think my absolute favorite was when I was writing wireless in college. I just sat there and I just stared at the paper. And when someone asked me what was wrong, I said, I made my villain too strong. I have no idea how to beat this villain. Like, Shock was too strong. I mean, how is anyone supposed to beat this guy? But you start to design the characters. You start to understand what they would and would not do. And as that happens, it's almost like a cause and effect chain reaction. This is where it starts to get funny, interesting, because as I said before, your story starts off with a before state. This is what the world was like before everything happened. This is how things would continue going on if nothing happened. But this is where the story comes in. You take something, a little event or motivation or whatnot, and you take your perfectly balanced world and you drop this in there like a comet or a meteorite. And this is where things start going crazy, because once you have your characters down pat, and once you have your world down pat, you can drop something random, like a fire broke out, or a new person comes in, or someone gains superpowers. It can be insane or simple. But just by dropping that in there, you suddenly have an entire story start to form out, because you start to realize that, okay, how would this person react to this? How would this person react to this? How would this person react to this person's reaction? And that's how the story starts to form itself, because you start to realize that, yeah, these people would react this way, and these people would react this way. These people would be upset about this. These people would be excited about this. These people would take advantage of it, but these people would try to stop them. And then as those characters interact, and as that delicate balance is just put into momentum and tries to regain balance with this new feature added into the world, that's when it starts to get exciting. That's when your story starts to come together. And one thing I will put in here is that a lot of new authors and young authors, because of Harry Potter and because of Game of Thrones and because of Hunger Games, there is often this belief that the only way you can add interest to a story is to kill people. This is not true. When I was in drama school, when I was studying drama in school, and we did the improv games and such, there was one guy, and every single time, I hated it so much when he would go up to do improv, because he would volunteer for every improv session, and his entire thing was, bang, I shoot you, you're dead now. Bang, I shoot you, you're dead now. And it's so stinking boring. Like, where are you supposed to go with that? What's that supposed to happen? And I think we often think, you know, well, killing them, because that's the worst thing we can think of. And I've killed my characters before. We just finished a story where characters have died in it. It's not bad to have a character die in a meaningful death and stuff like that. But I feel like we think that the death itself is what's meaningful. And the death itself is not what makes it meaningful. It's the loss that comes from that death. And this is where something that is called stakes comes into your story. Because what we really want isn't drama, it's stakes. And I don't mean medium rare and Salisbury and all that kind of stuff, although that would make me very hungry right now. What I mean is, why does this matter? Which again goes back to that why question. Why does anything happening right now matter? And you can do this to anything. I did a blog post for an author friend of mine once, and I used the example of chocolate sitting on a table and someone eating the chocolate. And you could just say, you know, someone's there and there's chocolate on the table, he eats the chocolate. That doesn't really matter. Or you can say, you know, someone was there and they were fighting for a diet for ages and they wanted to lose weight so they could, you know, win over and ask the girl of their dreams out, and how, you know, they went through all this struggle and they really loved candies, they really loved chocolates, but they put it all aside because really this their love for this girl was so much stronger. Finally, they lost the weight, they got handsome, they got a makeover, they go and ask her out and they find out she was already dating. And so, going back to the table, they see a chocolate sitting on the table. And with a defeated sigh, they eat the chocolate. Suddenly that has way more impact. It's not No one's died. Really, in the grand scheme of things, it's not that big of a thing. But because it matters so much to that character, and because it has so much impact to that character, the stakes have risen. And we can do it for anything. Let's see here. Plot point. Playing an improv game. Well, that's ironic and breaking the meta. They were in class, and they wanted to play an improv game because they knew that they had to go and they wanted to get the job in voice acting. They really wanted to get into voice acting, but every job they tried, it was flub. They couldn't read the script fast enough, and they couldn't wrap their heads around how to get over this thing, because everyone else can just grab the script and they read it instantly as they're reading. They can't keep up with that, and they have no place for them in acting. Finally, this one old voice actor comes up to them and tells them, you know what, maybe you can't read really fast, but I'll teach you something that will help you keep up with those guys and maybe even go further. And that's when they teach them improv through improv games, and they just do it week after week. But by learning the improv, he suddenly learns how, even if he can't read the script perfectly fast, if he messes up, he knows how to catch himself and keep it going, to the point that some of the writers actually enjoy his made up stuff a lot better than the real thing. See, that was just literally me, and as I read that, out of nowhere, coming up with that. You can put stakes on anything. One of my favorite examples of this is if you ever remember an old show called The Andy Griffith Program. This was an old black and white television show, probably wouldn't go over very well nowadays, but it was just about a sheriff in a small town. And here's the thing. The plot points in that show were very, very simple. I mean, oh, Aunt B made pickles and they taste horrible, but we don't want to hurt her feelings. Oh, Barney wants to sing, but he's a horrible singer. Oh, there's a new guy in town. We don't know if he's good or not. These are very, very simple, silly things. But they could make an entire episode seem interesting. And why? Because you make it matter to the characters. You make it matter to their plot. You make it really impactful for them. And when it matters to your characters, it'll matter to the reader. Even if in normal life, it wouldn't matter to the reader. And that's what you gotta wrap your head around, is that it's not about, you know, trying to think of the most extreme thing you can imagine. Oh, if we don't do this, then the orphans will die, and they will die in the most disgusting way I can possibly imagine. That really, eventually, at first, it will impact you, but it'll be like Attack on Titan. Attack on Titan has a lot of deaths in it. And after a while, people adapt to that, and they just kind of stop caring about any of the characters, because you never know when someone's going to die again. My drama teacher had a phrase, and he talked about the cheap, easy way to get reactions from people and the hard, longevity way to get reactions from people. So you have erotica, you have romance, you have crude humor, you have witty humor, you have horror, you have suspense. It's not that one will get a reaction, one won't, but one, they're going to get numb to eventually. Eventually, they're going to need a greater stimulation. Otherwise, they just won't find it as impactful as it used to be. Because it's about the shock. It's not about the wit and intelligence behind it. The other one, though, if it's well-crafted, it takes a lot more work to craft it well. But it's going to be pretty much timeless. Like, a good Hitchcock suspense one, it's still tense after all these years. Wait Until Dark. That is a tense movie. It's an old movie, but it's a tense movie. But I see a lot of horror movies and people are like laughing about, oh man, I can't believe I ever found that scary. The original King Kong, like not the Peter Jackson, I mean the original King Kong, had people running out of the theater screaming at how terrifying it was. Let me tell you right now, it is not terrifying. It is kind of hilarious, actually, with the King Kong character. So yeah, it does happen. So you got your history, you got your impactful thing which starts to affect your characters and such. You got yourself asking, okay, how do these affect our characters? How do we, you know, adapt to them? How does this go out into the storyline? Why does this matter to them? What are they trying to accomplish from it? Story's starting to write itself. And you're going to have what a lot of people call writer's block. I hate writer's block. I deal with it a lot. I'm stuck on writer's block on one story right now, and people are asking me, when's the next chapter coming out? When's the next chapter? I'm like, it's gonna come when it comes, because I can't write it. But if I'm to be honest with yourself, with myself, writer's block actually doesn't really exist. Not to the point that people think it exists. People think that writer's block is my brain has stopped being creative. My brain can't come up with new ideas. That's actually not what writer's block does. What writer's block actually is, it's you starting to doubt your own ability. It's you feeling like this matters too much and you have to make it good, but nothing you're writing seems good enough for what you think it's worth. And that doubt is strangling. I deal with that doubt a lot. I'm a major perfectionist. I struggle with it. I try to overcome it. But it's a huge problem. I mean, I'm doing a comic right now, and all I can think of is, man, I wish I could draw like these other characters, with these other people. My artwork has improved monumentally from where I was even like a year or two ago. And yet I'm still like, man, my artwork is so horrible. People like XKCD and Cyanide and Happiness are super famous. And I'm like, man, my artwork is terrible. I mean, even if it's illogical, it so just becomes a part of what we're thinking. And the only real solution to writer's block is just write. Like, forget about it, just write. And that's why, for me personally, I've adapted a 4+, mind blanking, draft system. First draft of your story, just write. Don't look back, don't question things. If something is really extreme, like, oh, this character has a monkey wrench, but we've never mentioned them having a monkey wrench before. Okay, yeah, you can go back and change that because it's going to be a pain to find afterwards. But for the most part, don't look back, don't reread, don't question anything. Just write until that story is out of your head. And honestly, it's probably going to be very short. Usually when I do the first draft, it's about 15,000 to 20,000 words. Alternate was like close to 70,000 words. Your classic novel is about 30 to 40,000. Usually 40,000 words is about as small as they'll let you go. But yeah, just write it out there. Second time you read through the book, what you're going to do, don't worry about grammar. Don't worry about spelling. Unless, of course, it's something really easy to change or really obvious, like, oh, I used the wrong name here. What you want to do is just read like a reader. And anything that breaks the flow, because every story has a flow to it. And anything that breaks that flow, anything that drags you out of the immersion of your story, try to fix. Try to get yourself back into that flow. Try to think of what do I need to do to get myself back into that flow. Because that flow is what keeps your story going. You can have a story with horrible grammar, horrible spelling, but as long as that flow is there, readers will come. Third draft is where you focus on the spelling and on the grammar and trying to get the polish down, stuff like that. Usually by then I start to send it out to a test audience as well. Once I get at least the first edit done on spelling and such. And for test audience, I try to get a little varied, you know, get girls, get guys, get people of different ages, get people of different kinds of personality types. Try to aim for what your target audience is, but it's interesting sometimes to get someone who's totally off the wall to see, oh, maybe someone will enjoy this who I didn't think would enjoy this. Happens sometimes. Then basically 4+ ones is just basically you going through and alternating between 2 and 3. And do more of that second kind of draft run where you're just trying to get the flow more than the third one. The third one, it's good to do by the end. Final one's going to be your read through. We're going to be doing the formatting, getting your chapters and everything figured out. That's usually just the fun stuff. But 2 is probably the most important read because that is the one that's going to keep your readers immersed. And it's hard. It's in some ways it's easy because you're not really viewing this as I need to take a fine tooth comb and find anything that is spelling wrong. No, you're reading through and anything that breaks your enjoyment of reading the book needs to be changed, needs to be altered. I think when I first published Aldenaire, I read through Aldenaire 36 times, which is why I'm still kind of ashamed at how many spelling errors and grammar errors there are in the book. I read it through it 36 times for editing and such. And I think the part that made me realize that I had something special there was on the end of my 36th time reading the book. I was at the climax of the story, and I finally finished the climax, and then I realized that I was standing crouched down on the chair, like, like this. And suddenly I realized, after 36 times, I'm still getting this reaction of it. This is probably a good sign. This is probably a good sign that there's something going on here. You've actually been talking for a while on this now. I enjoy storytelling. This is fun stuff. It's something that I can ramble on about for a while and such. While we finish up, there's going to be one more thing I'll throw in there, because it's something I see a lot of people talk about. Anyone who's gone through an English class will probably have heard the concept that the origin of all stories is tragedy. And I kind of see where they're coming from, because yes, there has to be something that goes wrong, something that matters to them that went wrong, because otherwise you have a really boring story. Because again, you have that balance, you need to have something that offsets that balance. Otherwise, it does end up being a boring story. You need to have things that matter to them. But I don't think, and this is just me personally, I don't think that a story has to be tragic to be good. A lot of people think that, oh, for anything to be good, it has to be focused on the tragedy. No, I don't think the tragedy is what draws readers into the story. I think that more than seeing people, because I've read stories where it's just like Lord of the Flies or Death of a Salesman or Lord Jim or any of those stories where it's just you sit there for hours and they accomplish nothing and just everything falls more and more apart. I don't think that is what really draws in the readers. If that's something you enjoy, well, more power to you. I mean, someone's got to buy those books. Not me. I don't want to buy those books. I think that life is too long and too short to have unhappy endings, and life has enough unhappy endings of their own. We don't need more of them in our stories as well. But while I think it's important to have hardships in your stories, I think what really draws readers into the stories isn't the fact that the hardship exists, but the fact that the main character overcomes that hardship. How does this change them as a person? Even if they end up worse for it, how did it change them as a person? How does this affect the people? There has to be some impact for all that happened, because we are dynamic people. We change. Things affect us. And I think that is really what draws people in. For me personally, I like it when they overcome hardships, when they decide to become a better person, when they have that turnaround type character type thing. Actually, I will throw one other thing in there, because it's kind of tied to this. And that is the fact that, you know, why is someone saying fireworks? Anyways, there are people who go through, and we had a network error. Okay, this is going to go on YouTube anyways, so that's all good. But there are people who go through, and one of the ones that I see a lot, this isn't only set to female or minorities or whatnot, but it's something that happens with those kinds of characters a lot, because they feel they have something to prove. And that is that they will try to create a character who is perfect. There is nothing more boring and unrealistic than a perfect character, because they are just unrelatable. We are not perfect beings. Nothing on us is perfect. I mean, let's take an example of a character who I think does that really, really well. We have Saitama from One Punch Man, the One Punch Man himself. Why is it so lovable an anime in spite of the fact that it's literally about a guy who wins every single fight in one punch? Like, that is just a gag that is willing to die out after so much time. But what draws people to him isn't the fact that will he win this fight or not? What draws people to him is that in spite of being so strong, personally wise, he is incredibly weak. He has a temper, he's very selfish, yet at other times he can also be very generous. He really wants to have fame. He really just has horrible luck. Like, he's doing all this work, and meanwhile, everything he does just ends up with nobody recognizing him, or just something goes horribly wrong. He's dead broke all the time. And in spite of being so absolutely strong, he struggles with so much stuff. Take in contrast a character who is there and it's like, they are strong. They are smarter than everyone else. And the only struggle they come up with for them is, but society was not willing to accept their genius, and so they struggle because everyone tells them they are wrong and they are should be sent to another place because they can't be a smart person. It's not about society. It is about that character themselves. It's not an interesting character. If you want to make your character have impact, if you want to have your character be someone who is someone who everyone will look up to, the whether it be guy, girl, white, black, human, alien, plant life, what will make your character super impactful and what will make them the characters that people feel their heart for is more about their struggles than their strengths. Because, and watching them overcome those struggles, watching them, you know, struggle through it and really still fight through it. Another good example, actually, Kim Possible. Kim Possible was an amazing show. I think anyone who's watched Kim Possible will admit it was a really good show. Kim Possible is a very unrealistically talented girl. She can do beat up bad guys and stop world crimes because she knows cheerleading. She has a father who is a rocket scientist and a mother who is a brain surgeon, and she's just as smart as both of them. Like, yes, she is very unrealistically strong. So why does she still work as a character? Because she's still also just a teenage girl. She struggles with, you know, social qualms. She struggles with worries. She has human things that she wants. Even if it's something silly as wanting a date for the prom or wanting that new item that she can't afford, she has struggles and they matter to her and she can't always overcome them. Sometimes she loses. Even Ron Stoppable, who is her, you know, foil in the fact that he's not that smart. We just had another internet drop, I think. He's not that smart and talented. He still has times where he wins. It's not all about Kim Possible being perfect and Ron Stoppable being silly. No, they both have that give and take and that relying upon each other, which makes them a very lovable combination. And I just want to see that applied more in people's stories because it really will make them more impactful. It will make people's causes more impactful. Don't write a character because you want them to be perfect, because you want to show the world that these people can be really strong. No, that's not going to work. If you want to make people realize that these people are strong, show them overcoming the hardships. Show them fighting through. Show them accepting their own weakness, not just the weakness that, oh, I live in a world that's against me. That is a boring story, because here's the thing. No matter how much the world is against you, you can't change the world, but you can go and try to improve yourself. Thank you for the follow, by the by. And that's something that I think we need in a lot more stories, because I think if we do that, we're going to see a lot less people arguing over, you know, oh, you know, they just were biased against it. No. Write a good character. Write a good character that they can't ignore. Write a good story that is a page turner. It doesn't matter what your main character is, who your main character is, whatnot is. Write them good. Write them really, really good and really, really relatable and really, really, really immersive. And it takes work, but it's really worth it. And I would love to see more characters like that. Fillmore, that was an amazing show as well. Even Recess. Man, there's a lot of good Disney shows, actually. I miss the good Disney shows. Gravity Falls, really good characters. Honestly, I feel like anime is kind of creaming Western shows in just how many good ones there are out there. There are a lot of bad ones. There's a lot of ones that are bad, but also have a bit of charm to them. I think in an extent, it's because there's just so stinking much of anime and manga. Like, there's such a large field to draw from that it's really easy to find good ones because there's just so much there. But at the same time, like, they ask the deep questions. They challenge their characters. They go and they make it matter. It doesn't matter, you know, what your main character is, who your main character is. They can make some really good characters. And so I see a lot of examples I wish would be applied to our Western storytelling as well. But yes, that is my ramble for today. That is, we are having enough internet issues right now that I probably am going to have to post the actual live video to YouTube as opposed to the just transferring over from Twitch. But thank you everyone for checking in. We have made it through. We have gone through July. We have gone through firework storms going outside. You know what? We're going to get through this. We're going to get through all this. I don't know what it's going to look like. I don't know what the future's going to hold, but we're going to get through this. And there's going to be people stronger, people weaker, but we're going to be here for each other through it all. Now, to end it off, because this is how we're ending off every single one of them, whether it works or not, we have the improv game again. Prepare to run away, everyone who doesn't want to see me horribly mangle an improv thing. Plot point. We have rivalry, which is actually a very fitting one for this stream. Character. We have a father. And for theme, we have a fairy tale. Okay, well, I guess we'll go with this then. Ugh, I can't believe that Mr. Cinderella person, his daughter's there, and he married a prince. Mine only married a regent. Ugh, what's with this? I go and put my daughter into the lovely, into the forest for days, teach her how to talk to animals, teach her how to go out and do all sorts of crazy things that shouldn't logically make any sense. But do we have random princes come here and try to win my daughter over? No, we don't. Ugh. I tell you, these fairy tale worlds, they just ain't fair. They just ain't fair, I tell you. Okay, that was bad. That was horrible. But thank you all for checking in. We will be back again tomorrow with Kuki for some crazy Minecraft shenanigans. Hopefully we'll have a bit more stable internet, though as this week's been going, probably not. But yes, keep safe, have a good week, and don't push yourself too hard. Take a break if you need it.